Welcome to another edition of Sound of Spurs podcast. I'm Bill Schoening, longtime radio voice of the Spurs. I missed this guy by 1 year. When I left, he came in, or when he left, I came in. I'm not sure how it worked. Jaren Jackson, a member of the 99 championship team, former Georgetown Hoya, former Spur, father of Jaren Jackson Jr., but we're not going to talk about that guy. He's not a Spur. This guy was.
That's right.
Hey, very good to see you, Jaren.
Oh, man, it's so great to be back here in San Antonio hanging out with you guys. I've been missing those go Spurs, go words for a long time, man, but it's still in my heart. I love these Spurs, and I wish them the best as they move forward.
It's the 50th anniversary of the Spurs organization, so they're bringing special guys like you that played on championship teams, were an important part of what happened here way back in the day in the Alamo Dome. And I know you've got fond memories, and we'll get to those in just a minute. But what's it going to be like for you tonight to hear those cheers from the crowd that remembers you so well?
Wow, man, it brings back a lot of good memories, and I'm looking forward to hearing those sounds, the Spurs love that they've always given, even after all these years. It's been amazing. So I remember how when I used to shake my head and do my thing, shooting my three-point shots, you know, and how crazy they were when I was doing that. So it seems like it's continuing to take place, man, here. So I can't wait to hear that noise.
Yeah, well, your basketball journey is one that did not have a direct path to the NBA. You were all over the place, my man. So let's talk for a moment just about where it all started in New Orleans. I guess growing up shooting at the playground, right? Tell us about your early life in basketball.
I mean, so I was fortunate enough to be a top player in high school coming out of uptown New Orleans. So it was some fine memories. And then I moved on to being recruited by Georgetown, as you mentioned, playing for Coach Thompson. In the legendary teams out of Georgetown, playing with the likes of Alonzo Mourning and Tim and Mutombo, guys like that. It prepared me for my moment where one day I'm going to play with David Robinson and Tim Duncan. So that's how I look at it. So we had some good days in Georgetown. Then I moved on and tried to establish my career in the pros. My journey is well documented. And then finally I had the pleasure and the blessing to join the San Antonio Spurs as a free agent. Coming out and was the best time of my life. I looked forward to taking advantage of the opportunity, and I appreciated what Coach Popovich did by bringing me in and allowing me to gel with such wonderful, wonderful players at the time. And it was the beginning of what is now the Spurs way, man. So I'm blessed.
Before you got here, though, I'm really interested about your journey because I know you played over in France for a while, right? In Lyon, France. I've been there. It's beautiful there. What was it like back then playing in Europe?
You know, that was that moment where, you know, a lot of young players that I even coach now in the G League who are trying to find their niche in the NBA, trying to get an opportunity to make it one day. And so I had a moment where I decided to go overseas and give it a try. And when I did, I decided to go to France. And I had a great time there. It was somewhat of a good fit. You know, it was an opportunity to make some money, a little extra money at a time. And this is before coming to the Spurs. And so now at that point, I found out that maybe overseas wasn't me. The team that I was with, although I had a great time, we kind of struggled. Mm-hmm. And so my time was limited over there. So I felt like I better just get my butt back to the States and play in the NBA. And hopefully I can get back to the right team, continuing to climb through at the time, the CBA, which is now the G League. And the opportunity came to join the Spurs. So that's how I taste overseas, and a lot of players like that that are on the come up. Guys who are not fortunate enough to get drafted, the top guys, not like the Tim Duncans and the Jaren Jackson Juniors. So that's my path, and I appreciate it. And I shared it with my son, by the way, that path. You know, so I guess that's why he worked so hard to be drafted and not have to do all the stuff I did. So, but it was a great journey, and I'm just glad it ended up with the Spurs.
Well, you come to the Spurs, and what a front court, right, with David Robinson and Tim Duncan. How did you find yourself acclimating? You were in the backcourt, of course, but how did you find yourself acclimating to the teammates around you when you first got in?
Oh, man. I thought that was the first time playing with such dynamic big guys for me in the pros and getting an opportunity to play. So my goal and my focus was more on how can I best fit with those guys to play with these guys. These are not two point guards. You're playing with two bigs who are Hall of Fame bigs. At the time, you know, you got the young Tim Duncan and you got David who already established himself as a Hall of Famer. So, and he hadn't won a championship at the time. So I knew that was his goal and the vision for the Spurs. And I didn't want to come in and make any mistakes at the same time, gel as a pro. And I found a way to mesh with these guys, make sure I just give them the ball in the post, and make life easy for them. And if they did not want to share the ball with me, it's okay, but I'm out there just in case they get doubled and just in case I can get a good look. And I had to make the shot. And when I did, I shook my head, man. Like, oh, man, like all those shots I made. So it was good old days. It was a blessing. And I appreciated the opportunity to play with David and Tim.
Yeah, and you also got to play with Avery Johnson. And everybody's got the Avery stories. And, of course, he's a New Orleans guy, too. I was just going to bring that up. Yeah. So was there a special bond between you and him? I know there's a special bond between Avery and everybody because that's the way he is. But in terms of, you know, being from the same area?
All my homeboys, man, we always have that bond. You know, I love playing with Avery. He was a true leader, as you well know of him. You know, he has been amazing throughout his career. He has somewhat of a journey like I did. So we kind of crossed paths when we joined the Spurs together, and it was just refreshing to see. And I know he's a New Orleans guy, a St. Augustine guy. I'm a Walter Alcorn guy. So for those of you all that know New Orleans, you know those two teams, they need to clash more, you know, in the future. But I have much respect to my point guard, Avery. It was a blessing to play with him as well. And he was the right fit for the type of guys we had on that team. And I just tried to find my way to gel with those guys. And I think we did a magnificent job, and it led to that first championship.
That was a very unique season because you guys only played 50 regular season games. It was a lockout year, and you got off to a slow start, as I recall.
Right. It was slow in the beginning. You know, we were trying to figure the team out and what best fit. You know, I found a nice little role coming off the bench. You know, at the time, I think from what I remember Sean Elliott having it was a little rocky start in the beginning as far as him playing, you know, and fitting in. And then, you know, Coach Pop was trying to fit me in the beginning, and I was playing very well. But I think to the amazement of Coach Popovich, he found a way to get the right chemistry and the right rotation and found a way to get me acclimated to some playing time off the bench. And it helped us, you know. So we thrived during that year. The lockout year. I hate using that term.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was just a great season for us. And I think whoever would have won the championship, we would embrace it. So it was our 1999 NBA World Championship year.
You had some good hard-nosed players in that team, too. Guys we've had on the podcast in the last couple of weeks, as a matter of fact, including Mario Elie,
yes,
and Malik Rose.
Yes.
What did they bring to the club?
Toughness. That was kind of like the identity of the team. You know, we were inside-out team, but we were a tough team defensively. I think it had to take place. So all the shot blocking we got in the back end, those guys held us accountable on defense. So we had to play our man. And so we had to do that and be tough at it. And you pick the right guys. You know, Mario, who was great, and he has a history with Houston. Then he comes here to San Antonio, wins another championship. Amazing. He and I go back a ways, you know. He got somewhat the same journey coming out of playing in the CBA.
Right.
And so I'm well aware of his journey, as well as Malik Rose at the time, young guy trying to make it on the team. So, and I have a lot of love for both of those guys. I see Malik a lot with the NBA G League now. You know, we have little small talks here and there talking about old memories, but it was some good old days, and I anticipate a few more conversations with those guys.
The fact that you had less than an easy journey, does that make you appreciate where you got to eventually even more?
Absolutely, man. Such a journey. Sometimes you're not as easy to get the opportunity to play in the NBA after being drafted. I wasn't drafted. Many of my friends, guys who are here now with me, they were not drafted. These guys had dreams of playing in the NBA like I did. And the opportunity to get it, you appreciate it. I knew my history. I understand where I came from. You highlighted New Orleans. I knew where I was coming from. And so I was fearless. I understand the magnitude of where I came from and how far I had to go coming out of not getting drafted, going through all the travels through the CBA and now the G League. Those guys, much shout out to the Austin Spurs and all the guys. And so I understand that journey. And so to finally get a chance to play with the NBA star players like Timmy and David, Sean Elliott and all those guys, man, it was just an amazing opportunity. And I'm so appreciative of it to this day. So appreciation is the correct word, man.
You also got to play for a Hall of Fame coach in Greg Popovich.
Let me not. Come on, man. Coach Pop, he is the reason there is why there's such a thing as the Spurs way. He resonates in the NBA, in the game of basketball. So many people follow him, follow his philosophy. He's taught so many different coaches that are in the game now. You see it throughout the NBA, even in college. It resonates, and it resonates with me as well as I continue to move on in my own coaching aspirations as a pro coach and my time coaching my son in high school and my time now coaching in the G League. So I'm looking forward to more opportunities to continue that message as a coach the Spurs way, like Coach Pop is continuing to do, man. So he has been an amazing ambassador to the game. And it's going to be highlighted even more once he's done the coaching, but I don't see that. I think he's going to be coaching a long time. Unless you guys tell me something, man. Coach Pop, keep coaching, man.
He certainly has earned the right to call it quits whenever he wants to. Hey, usually I ask the final question, that is, what is the Spurs legacy? But I think you just answered that.
Yes.
And relationships are a very important part of that, right?
Absolutely, man. I mean, I think the Spurs are teaching other teams how to be pros, how to manage a team. I look at more the Spurs as more than being a team. They are a program. It's kind of like a college program, you know. And no disrespect to colleges, you know, but Coach Pop, there's a culture here in San Antonio with the Spurs. That culture I've so appreciated and respected as a former player, and you see that throughout the NBA. You see that throughout coaching. You see that throughout playing. And that's why even this year, you know, I have much respect for these young players that are trying to play. Romeo and all the guys, Kata Bates, my man Jeremy Sohan, all these young players who are trying to make it, doing a tough year. They're playing the right way. They're playing like the Spurs way. And they got a bright future here with the Spurs, if not elsewhere in the NBA. But it's definitely they're showing some good things with the Spurs. I appreciate that when I watch the Spurs, no matter what the result is at the end of the game. They're playing the right way. And that's because of what Coach Pop has done establishing the Spurs way. That's why I wear this ring with pride.
And you should. Thanks very much for those comments. It was great, you know, because this has been a kind of a tough year as far as wins and losses are concerned. But I'm with you. I've enjoyed watching these guys play, and they're growing up right in front of us, and I think the future's bright. Jaren, thank you very much for the time.
We appreciate
that. And I'm hoping that you enjoy the ovation that you're going
to
get tonight.
Oh, man, I'm looking forward to it, man, to do this. Oh, man, I can cry, man. And to do this in front of my son. Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh. Can y'all imagine this? This is going to be an awesome evening, and I'm just glad I'm here with loved ones, friends, and family, man. It's just a beautiful, beautiful moment, and I'm appreciative of everything that's going to be coming tonight.
Jaren Jackson, member of the 99 championship team, 4 years with the San Antonio Spurs. Great to have him this evening on the Sound of Spurs podcast, presented by SWBC. So long, everybody.